Chelsey! Book him out!
You can't make me!
What's wrong? After you read that book, you locked yourself in there.
I'm never coming out again.
What happened?
He's dead!
Who's dead?
He's dead.
Who died? Who died? Who died?
English!
English can't die.
Yes, it can. It was butchered.
Come on, it can't be that bad.
I'm never coming out.
Loki, I will break the door down. Come out. Jeez.
You read it.
I get by with a little help from my friends. Yeah, I get high with a little help from my friends. Welcome to a special episode of Death of the Author Reviews. He was so young, and now English is dead. He's dead, Loki, he's dead. The book killed him. There wasn't even a body. Aren't you gonna say something? Okay. Aren't you gonna say something? He's dead. The book murdered the English language with the same amount of curiosity as a lion. A hungry lion. A lame gazelle. Oh my god, I think it broke your brain. Can't you speak? I don't think there's a hope for you. Are you still able to do the review? Oh my god, I think you're killing him more. Really? Angela, Maddie, and Zoe are three best friends going into grade 10, and they want to be friends forever and ever. Because remember, kids, the best years of your life are in high school. I wish you weren't broken. The book was written entirely in chatspeak, and even the pages are formatted like a 90s MSN conversation. Thank you, Captain Obvious. Angela is the blue text and is Friendship Barbie. Everything will be fine as long as they remain friends. And most importantly, she likes boys. Maddie is the bold black text, and she's just negative and has horrible self-esteem. Everything that comes out of her mouth is awful and a put-down.
She's a scum-sucking road whore. She ruined my life.
She's fabulous, but she's evil.
And finally, there's Zoe. As far as we can tell, she's Asian with strict parents. She finds religion over the course of the book. But don't worry, you're never going to keep these three straight. Not until the end of the book when one shuts up for a while. Right, so? What?
You've got what I call
rich white girl problems. It's a tough world out there. I know, I've been through it. You only get one senior year. Enjoy it.
Ma'am, do you have this in the next size up?
Sorry, we only carry sizes 1, 3, and 5. You could try Sears.
He'll keep calling me. He'll keep calling me until I come over. He'll make me feel guilty. This is ridiculous, okay? I'll go. Shit.
These sweatpants are all that fits me right now.
I'm about ready to beat myself over the head with a rock and call it a day. What about you? Oh, Lord. Put me out of my misery now. All we get is their conversations to tell us what's going on. And of course, to seem hip and cool, the author put in a bunch of pop references that only 15-year-olds would get. But of course, this book was written 5 or 6 years ago, so only 20-year-olds would get the references now.
I am a loser, Gordo.
What? You're so not. And since when do you listen to what Kate says?
Well, since she's right. I mean, when I go to high school, what am I gonna be? Nothing. A second-class citizen of Loserville, USA. Population? Me.
As my inarticulate friend over here has said, there are many references to Lizzie McGuire and That 70s Show, and other movies and TV shows and music that 15-year-olds today wouldn't get. I don't think anybody can relate to some of their conversations. The author tries really hard to talk like a 15-year-old, but ends up sounding really contrived and sometimes really ridiculous. Sometimes she goes way too far. There have been gross-out moments in some movies these days, but none of them go as far as some of these moments. What a wonderful world. The dialogue, it sometimes seems really forced to push along the plot. And you came up with this analogy all on your own?
How are we gonna get those darn cows to that fair? Those damn city slickers, they've been coming in and tipping our cows! How are we gonna get them to the fair so that Betty May, sweet Betty May, how is she gonna make those meat pies if we can't get those cows to the fair?
That's right. There's a reference to cow tipping in this novel. But moving on. Each girl has their own set of problems. Like Angela. She judges her self-worth by whether she has a boyfriend or not, and her whole plot arc revolves around her chasing various boys. That's right, and we'll stay true blue forever and ever, and we'll all three go to the same college and fall in love with three awesome guys who are also best friends and will be bridesmaids in each other's weddings and live happily ever after. Sigh. Maddie's arc involves the popular girl. Maddie wants to fall into the cool crowd and forgets all about her true blue friends. Ow, actually that hurt. Exactly. You can't make new friends. You know, you have us. Forever. And Zoe has a little something-something going on with her teacher. Yeah, you know, we talk about stuff. Takes her to Christian fellowship, and you know, the usual. Yeah, exactly. He wants to, you know, read the Bible with her. So, like all teenagers, when he's making her uncomfortable and slowly heading for her private square, they decide not to talk to an adult. No. You mean, oh no, we might cause the ancient 24-year-old to lose his job. T-I-N-O-S-A, you are a dinosaur. T-I-N-O-S-A, you are a dinosaur. O-L-D-M, man, you're just an old man hitting on me, what? You need a CAT scan. But in all honesty, these girls have some severe self-esteem issues.
because it all has to do with boys. Their self-esteem issues cause so many problems in the book. Angela's always chasing after another boy, and Zoe can't tell that the creepy teacher is hitting on her because why would anyone like me? Maddie starts hanging out with the popular crowd, and it makes her feel special. So that kind of has to do with self-esteem, too. The only redeeming sentence I could find in the book that had to do with good self-esteem was this. How could he go out with her when he could have me? It was like, wow. Thank you. That is the question you should be asking, and it only took you 193 pages. No. Please, no. This book is packed with horrible morals for teenage girls. 1. Boys won't like you if you don't wear makeup. 2. Never tell an adult anything, they will never understand you. 3. Always keep your friends' secrets no matter how concerned you are for them. 4. All women must be properly groomed to the standards of beauty and porn magazines at all times. 5. And remember, ladies, all that really matters is your bikini. This book is entertaining, but what you really need to enjoy it is a good pen and some friends to share it with. It's ridiculous and slightly outdated. I know. But hey! I think I figured out a way to, you know, fix you and give you the closure you need. Come on. Now he has a grave to remember him by. Ttyl!